Welcome to Game Changers by Leyline, the Leyline podcast about changing the game and changing the world. Why? Because Leyline is doing that. We are changing the world by making a game of altruism and charity and doing good stuff. You do good stuff, you get good stuff. And we are adding all sorts of amazing... I'm so sorry. Boogie's making some motions at me. I don't know what you're trying to say.
To what you were saying earlier. And I was like, Say it.
We are hashtag family friendly. Or we try to be. Sometimes, you know, PG-13 maybe. I don't know. But yeah, we got a podcast where we talk about changing the game, doing some amazing stuff in the world. And that's what Leyline's all about, and trying to reward people for doing it. And so I'm one of your hosts, Cody Urban, with some amazing hosts, Justin, a.k.a. Boogie, and Crystal.
Hi.
And we got a game changer here, Tim Tello, who is the COO of Pocketful of Quarters, a company that is set up to become the universal cryptocurrency for games. That's pretty darn cool. And so a few of us are on different paths of learning the world of cryptocurrencies and blockchain technology. It's a big deal. Leyline's trying to use that in the gamification, where we can use that for rewarding players through NFTs, through crypto collectibles that you can be rewarded with by doing altruistic good deeds, like, you know, running Boink and helping science, maybe giving blood, maybe donating to Goodwill. I mean, the list will grow and grow and grow and grow. Even exercise and getting a good night's sleep. That's why these weights are right here, because I was making sure I did my exercise today before I clicked that button and earned my 10 Leyline points for today, which I can use on, you know, Bitcoin or Amazon. I'm eyeing those Chipotle gift cards. I got a family of five that I need to feed, so hopefully those don't sell out. But anyway, enough about that. Let's talk about a game changer that we got on the podcast today, Tim Tello. Tell us a little bit about yourself. What you got going on? You got some amazing stuff going on.
Yeah, we're doing pretty well with Quarters. We've been around for about 3 years now. Have investors like Tim Draper, Michelle Phan, some big hitters in both crypto and the influencer space. We've recently, with COVID, we pivoted to creating an esports platform over the last year, and you know, we've grown it to about 300,000 users. It's growing about 30,000 users every week. It's really red hot right now, and we're just trying to maintain and move into another funding round.
Right on. You know, let's if somebody said, okay, Pocketful of Quarters, I said this whole thing about, you know, it's a cryptocurrency game. But what is your elevator pitch on what Pocketful of Quarters is?
Yeah, it's bringing the arcade back, right? It's Pocketful of Quarters is making the world one universal gaming token. Back, you know, the 80s, quarter was king, right? I think that, you know, there's 2 million games out there, and not one of them share a coin. You know, there's some that share names. Nexon has their Nexon coin in a lot of different games. Zynga, back before they got kicked off of Facebook, did have coins that could be represented between other games. You know, their Zynga Poker series, which was really cool, and people loved it. And I really think that was what shaped Zynga. You know, my buddy Mike Pagano was on that team, and they really pushed that out. And I think what we're trying to do, and you know, at the end of the day, what we're building is Roblox 2.0. And usually when you say that, you don't have to, you know, have an elevator pitch. We're bringing the sandbox to the world. We're giving you an easy to apply SDK that you could line up and create your own coins, mint your own coins. You don't have to use Quarters, call it what you want, share it, you know, make coins for your games. And you know, I think that's a far better ask for any players out there.
Right on. Crystal's
looking. That sounds awesome because I grew up in the arcade, man. I loved it, because down before COVID hit, there's one probably about an hour away from me where there's an arcade where you can put in nickels, and it's like all the old school arcades. And I just remember being like an only child, and then my uncle had came back. He had just turned 21, came back from Vegas and gave me $200 in quarters, and I almost crapped myself. And then down like probably about a mile and a half from my house, when you were allowed to walk, you know, to a place like that when you're 8 or 9.
Safer like, times, apparently.
Yeah, safer times. I spend all day there on a couple quarters. Just, oh man, it's so much entertainment. And then you just made cool friends that were gamers, you know. It was like a different thing, you know. Couldn't afford too many at home stuff, you know, in the home consoles. So it was just like my uncle won, and he brought me back some quarters. Like, go have fun. And I nerded out so hard. Oh, I nerded out. Double Dragon. I don't know. That's old. But I remember playing Double Dragon.
That's before my time.
Well, I'm going to go kill myself now. Goodbye. All right.
It was funny. Your uncle brought the quarters back from Vegas. My parents took me to Vegas, but then put my brother and I into the arcade at the casino.
Oh, my God.
The hotel had an arcade, and that was like babysitting. You know, hey, we'll just give you a pocket full of quarters. That was paying for babysitting. And, man, I got so good at Primal Rage. That was a great game. What was his name? It was like the Brontosaurus-y guy that could squirt acid. I feel like his name started with a V. But that was my guy. And for like one quarter, man, I could last the longest time. Like people with new challengers, they put their quarter on the thing. Like, and it's like, that's their spot. Cool. I'm going to take you down. And then I would take him down. And man, I would just last for so long. Those were good old days, you know?
I miss going to the arcade.
Yeah. My game was a little bit different. I was a Blitz 2000 player. I loved it so much. And I had a similar story. My mom went to Boomtown, which is, you know, the closest casino to Texas. And she dropped, you had to follow the little red line, you know, and you stay on the red line and it takes you right to the arcade. Here you go. Stay here.
Right?
Don't go anywhere.
I'll come back in a couple hours. You stay here.
And, you know? Like if, and you run out of quarters. It's like, all right, now what?
Now what do I do?
I lost all my quarters.
You're just standing on a line because you're not allowed to move off of it, and you're just screaming across the casino, Mom! And 20 ladies are like looking at you like, I'm not your mom.
Have their kids at the arcade.
Yeah.
Gave them a pocket full of quarters, each of them.
So
Tim, tell us more about, because I know you were nominated for Forbes 30 Under 30. Can you tell us more about that and how that got started?
Yeah, so, you know, we had a really big year. So I was working on licensing, and we did like the Narcos game, the Ultra Carbon game. And so I did a lot of outsourcing to Europe. So I was nominated both in the US and in Europe. You know, there's a little bit of corporate bureaucracy there. You know, you got to kiss the hand. And so what I didn't know is when you get nominated, they ask you to either come to Boston if you're nominated in America, or Stockholm if you were nominated in Europe. And, you know, we were moving at the time of one of them, and Stockholm was too far for me to just travel to go to like a 2-day event. So I was like, no, I ended up not going. And then I did not get 30 under 30. So it's been like one of those things that, you know, I've had the nomination. I have like the little like congratulations plaque, but like I don't have the magazine, and I'm chasing 40 under 40 so hard. And my wife, she's 28. She's like, I'm going to get 30 under 30 for us. You watch. We're tellos together. So hopefully she gets it, you know, but I got a consolation, you know. I was in Find Your Grind as best in games for BD. Find Your Grind is a cool organization founded by the CEO of Monster. You know, it helps kids find alternate paths to, you know, think careers that are outside of what you think are the right careers, you know, like going to be a lawyer or a doctor. You know, you can make just as much money being a video game developer as you could ever make as a doctor. Probably more. If you have a game that's great, you could become a billionaire very quickly, right? So, you know, he's leading a charge to, you know, change the mindset. You know, I grew up, you got to be one of these two things. And if you're not one of those two things, if you're going to play games all your life, you know, you're never going to amount to nothing, Tim. Well, you know, Mom, you were wrong.
30 under 30. Yeah.
I was just talking to my students about a similar concept where, you know, I mean, if we just ate, slept, breathed, and worked to afford to do it, right? Yeah. I don't know, where's the color in life? Like, I just feel like life is just kind of a droning grayscale type of monotonous existence. It is the things like in the arts, media, and entertainment. My subject that I teach is, we call media arts. You know, it's like digital media. It's art, though. It's how to do music, video, and game design. Game design integration is actually part of it. And it's things like that that enrich life, like bring color and flavor to life. I feel like, not, I mean, not that, you know, maybe a walk in nature and stuff wouldn't do that too, but you know, it's like people like to downplay some of the artistic, you know, game like fields of careers. And yet the people putting those down, if they didn't have them, they would agree their life would be pretty boring. You know, I didn't have music to listen to. I don't have movies to go or TV shows to go watch. I don't have games to play. I don't have Super Bowl coming up. You know, I mean, it's like any type of game. It's like you take all that away. Well, dang, I'm just eating and sleeping and working to live and living to work, eat and sleep. Dang, what's my point of living? So, yeah, it's an interesting point that you just brought up, just how that we need to change that mindset, I think, you know, and be willing to go, you know what? Yeah, some people are going to be doctors and lawyers and whatnot. And we need people in trades, plumbers, electricians. Thank God for them. You know, let's not downplay the blue collar stuff, as well as people who are doing things like game development. Thank you. Thank you for doing that and making life even more fun and exciting.
Yeah. So that's what the whole charity is about, right? It's finding what you're passionate about, you know, and then, you know, when you become one of the mentors on Find Your Grind, those kids that have maybe some admiration to be what you are, you know, they have a direct line of communication with you to reach out. You know, there's MLB baseball players on there. There's Olympic gold medalists on there. It's pretty cool. You know, he's doing some really cool stuff to help kids, you know, get out of that one way path and open up their, you know, their minds to creativity.
Let's get them on the podcast too.
I can connect you with them. They work directly with Rekt. Rekt Global is helping them do a lot of their stuff.
Nice. That would be way awesome. I have a question from chat about Pocketful Quarters. What do you think is the most interesting game in your ecosystem?
Well, you know, right now we have games on both the Apple and the Google Store. But you know, they're really more of a proof of concept. And so on the esports platform, you know, we're very Fortnite heavy. But I really think we're moving into a shift to Call of Duty. We're going to be, I think, the first people to get auto scoring in Call of Duty, for like an actual platform. I mean, they have some, you know, there's some, scores out there like Call of Duty trackers. I think we're going to be the first ones to have like an auto score fully function, like kind of like Mayhem was for Fortnite. So I think that's probably like the next big step for us. And then, you know, we might go backwards a little bit and fill that void for Fortnite. But right now I'm looking to really seed ourselves pretty strongly in the Call of Duty community.
Right on. We have a student ambassador, who Rohan, he used to play Call of Duty professionally.
Oh, yeah.
Guy is a wizard. I see you, Rohan. He's a good dude. He's a very, very good dude. I had a question about the coins for your platform. How does one obtain these coins? Do they purchase them and then participate, or how does it work them?
Yeah, you get so just when you sign up for the platform, you're gonna get free coins. And then we've also created one of the first ever verified Discord bots. So if you join our Discord, you'll get more coins. And then for being active within our community, every day you can get a bonus of coins. So you really never have to purchase anything ever. The real idea of POQ is having an opportunity to go play with high-level amateur esports players. And then, you know, having something to ante just makes it a little bit funner, right? There's something on the line, and you can take those coins that you've won. You know, we put them all up for you guys, and you can take those to the prize store. You could buy computers. You can buy V-Bucks. You could buy gift cards, whatever you like, you know. So if you're a solid player, you know, you're gonna end up taking home a lot. We gave away $100,000 last year to players coming on and just winning events.
That makes me wish I was better at video games.
Me too.
A lot. It's interesting. We kind of have a similar like prize pool ish sort of thing with ley line points. So you do good things in the world, you get ley line points, and then you get a real world, you know, gift card. I would love. I'd love to see some of those coins in there, man. People, ooh, you know, donating their computers to science and stuff.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure I offered Jeremy to use our coins. He said maybe. That give me a
Jeremy, are you listening to this? Are you listening, Jeremy?
I did, maybe. But I'm almost certain I offered. I'm almost certain I offered.
Right on. Yeah. Well, I think it's tremendous what you're doing. That's so good. The arcade was such a big thing growing up, and that, yeah, you know, instead of beating one of the guys that were there, and I would rather them take me under the wing, you know, if I got lucky in Mortal Kombat and the tough guy in the arcade's like, hey, move away from the arcade now. Okay, I'm out of here. Sorry, sir. yeah, that's wonderful. I love that. Thank you so much for doing that. That's great, man. Yeah.
I'm on your website right now, and stream can also see it. I signed up, and I already have 200 points. Yay.
Yeah, and so I see, as soon as you sign up, you get the coins.
Yeah, I see some Scribble-O, which we play for Community Nights, which is cool. Yeah, this looks... Can't wait to try this out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know,
if POQ. Anyone... Oh, yeah.
If anyone wants to, you know, try it out that's watching, you know, if they reach out to me on Discord, I'm happy to, you know, help them out, give them some extra quarters to go and play and enjoy.
Ooh, the website is POQ.gg, guys. If someone can write it in chat, that'd be great.
POQ. I've got a pocket, got a pocket full of quarters.
Nice.
Turn everything into a song. You should have been a musical artist.
Nah, I'm just more like a karaoke guy.
Karaoke champ.
Yeah.
Yes.
So
I feel like you guys are all built for radio. You guys all have radio voices, and I don't.
Really? You sound great. Man. Yeah.
You sound great.
Yeah, you're fine.
But I'll take that compliment, and that's it. I'm out. So, bye, everybody.
Said I have a radio face. Radio face.
what was the inspiration behind combining crypto and gaming?
You know, that was really George. So George is Mike, the CEO's son. And one day his dad was like sitting down and he was talking to him about how crypto works. So Mike has a computer doctorate in computer science from Stanford and Princeton. Wicked smart guy. He's been in tech investing for like the last 10 years, maybe a little bit longer. But he was explaining to George how it all worked. And George was really frustrated because it was early Fortnite days. And he's like, you know, I just want to stop playing Madden and go play Fortnite. Why is it that I have to buy and spend any more of my money when I have money in Madden? Like, why can't I just move it? And he's like, well, it doesn't work that way. You know, they'd have to have some kind of, and I guess a light bulb popped in his head. This could work over blockchain. Like, you could create and utilize the ledger to create transactions that moved from one game to the next. And, you know, as it evolved and, you know, it kind of went viral with George being a 12-year-old CEO, you know.
Doogie Howser of cryptocurrency games.
he has school duties, so he's no longer the CEO, but he does sit on the board and advises us on what kids are thinking about and, you know, how we should be retroactively pursuing things that, you know, that his generation thinks is important. So I think that's what keeps us like really on top of things. But you know, he had the idea and at first they were like, oh, all games should share coin. And I was early 2017. I had a funny story. Actually, I had my own dev studio, two of my buddies. We had a game that we were about to like sell to Game Pass. And, you know, at the time though, we had no money. We'd been developing this game for like 2.5 years and I had like $1,000 and I wanted to ask my wife to marry me and I put it into cryptocurrency. And I told my buddy, I was like, whatever I make, that's what her ring's gonna cost. I don't know what it is. And I literally hit like the right numbers. I was like, okay, I literally jumped in. I bought like XRP, then I moved over to another coin. I ended up coming out like $57,000.
Holla, let's go. Ring.
Paper. Off of a $1,000 investment in like 3 months.
That's a mediocre return. Mediocre.
Yeah. Well, 2017 was crazy, right? We were all making stupid money. So
I was being sarcastic, by the way. That's a great return.
Yeah. My buddies, like, you know, they're bigger bet takers than me, but they followed me. And one buddy of mine actually bought a house with his he put in like $10,000. He bought a house and his wife a car. and Let's it was go. Crazy. But like, so I was like, and my buddy was like, dude, put half that money in the company, like half of it, like buy $25,000 a nice ring. And I was like, nah, dude, I'm going to buy her the ring. Whatever I made, I knew I was going to do it. So my wife walks around the rock now. But that got me into crypto.
Does it have wheels on it? Is she like have big shoulders now from carrying it? It must be the size.
Better have like Bluetooth and.
She's like this big. My wife's like 5'1" and like 100 pounds. She's so little. I literally call her tiny. She's so small. And the ring is probably the size of her hand. No, it's not. Wow. It's just really nice diamond.
It's a tenth her body weight, though.
That's awesome, though.
Yeah. So it's one of those things that like really like made me love blockchain and crypto like so fast, right? And so I started looking around like, what is people doing? I thought it should be an esports platform. I thought there was an obvious like poker chip that could be put into video games. And so I started researching and I found Mike and I reached out and I said, hey, you know, you could do this with me or I'm going to do this without you. You don't know anyone in games. I know everyone in games. Good luck without me. he's like, come on, let's do this together. And I was like, let's do this together because you know way more about tech. And I made him think that I knew a lot more than I did, I guess. But he was always that computer science part that I needed, right? I was the BD guy. He was the computer science guy. We just took off. And so that's really kind of how it started. And we went legal first. You know, a lot of people wanted us to go ICO because it was still 2017. We could have gone ICO and raised millions of dollars, but we didn't do that. And we actually worked directly with the SEC for over a year and became the first ever ERC-20 token to get a no action letter, which you guys know they write one like every 10 years, basically. So, you know, we're kind of the founding footstep in blockchain to become legal and, you know, nationally recognized.
That's crazy. How much overlap is there between crypto and gaming?
I think there's a lot, you know, I think there's a lot of opportunity for crypto and gaming. I think when you think about cryptocurrency and the decentralization of, you know, financial economies, the only real way to mass adoption, I think, is through gaming, right? There's 2.8 billion people that recognize as gamers in the world. And there's 8 billion people in the world. So, you know, you're talking about a third of the world recognizes themselves as gamers.
It's a lot of nerds.
Well, now it's cool to be a nerd, right?
Yeah, right, yeah.
Not when we were kids.
No.
Hell no.
I was the closet nerd. Look, I was like the athlete. This is a state championship helmet where...
Yeah,
but I could not tell my friends that I was down with Star Wars. They were like, they're like, nah, bro, you gotta get out of here.
Being a nerd is a new norm, I feel like.
It was, and so yeah. So different. But yeah, so that it really, you know, kind of lost my train of thought there
about overlapping crypto and gaming.
Yeah. So I just feel like, you know, there's that third, and then you look at the other thirds that are out there. They're very older people. They're not really computer savvy. The millennials and the Generation Z, you know, they're all gamers and they're the computer savvy. They're the ones who are starting to question, you know, politics, are starting to question centralized banking. They're starting to question everything, right? Education system. They're starting to, you know, you look at what happened with GameStop, right? Give us $600 stimulus check and watch us beat up a hedge fund. Check this out.
Like, crazy.
That was crazy.
And these are kids that are just, you know, that no longer want to go to college. They're just, I can learn whatever I need to learn on the internet and you can't tell me any better. And, you know, going to them and getting them to be the first adopters of cryptocurrency is the only route to full on encompassing what blockchain could ever be.
That's awesome. Totally agree. So you would say that the average gamer is definitely ready for crypto then?
Oh, 100%. I think the average gamer is light years ahead of, you know, their parents when it comes to, you know, I mean, these kids are like building their, like, you know, when I was a kid, building a game was not even close to fathomable in my mind. These kids are playing Minecraft and Roblox, building their own games. Like, they're so far ahead, like, technology-wise. It's crazy. You know, they're already game developers. I made a joke before we came on that all game people, you know, are creatures of their cave. These kids are creatures of their cave. They're sitting in their room and they're just gaming 24/7. They're making their own games. They're playing other people's games. It's nuts. I've never seen anything like it.
The idea of NFTs, I would just say, you know, like the value in a digital asset, you know, to spend actual money on something like that, or time to grind for things and actually maybe sell that asset. I don't know how legal that is always, but, you know, but I mean, I just, yeah, this young in generation is definitely seeing that a lot more than maybe somebody much older than myself, right? Yeah, somebody who's, you're spending all this time in this fake world. Well, what is paper money, right? Yeah. You know, it's physical, it's tangible, but it's piece of paper. It represents something else. So, and then you've got a digital bank account. I mean, you know what I mean? It's like, this generation,
smart man, they're that paper money, they realize does not represent anything anymore, right? The gold standard was removed in 1973-ish with Richard Nixon. You know, there is no, there may be gold at Fort Knox, but there's not a piece of gold for every dollar. And banks are able to create inflation however they want. And so, you know, blockchain has to be the universal fix for all of that, right? Bitcoin erases inflation on its own, right? There's only so much ever in supply, and you can never make more. And every time we go through a halving section, it corrects itself. You know, we never have to deal with that. But banks, every time you give a bank $10, you know, they'll take and give a $9 away, but that $10 sits digitally in their system, and then that $9 comes back and they give $8 away. And that they only have to hold that $1. And that's crazy to me. And I think all these kids are starting to question that. And they're like, look, this isn't how things are going to work in the future. And, you know, they're holding on to, you know, like you said, like NFTs, the Pokemon cards are becoming more and more valuable. Like just things that have, like, you know, their own special value to them outside of money is holding value. And it's because this generation just, I feel like it's because this generation does not trust the centralization of banking and how things are working.
Well, look what they've done for us. Hey, yeah. Right. I mean, it's wild. What would you say to somebody that's like skeptical of cryptocurrency?
I'd probably ask them how old they were. And then as soon as I ask that, I'd probably say, do you understand how a loan works? And when they tried to explain to me how a bank loan works, I would immediately stop them and tell them how a bank loan works and why it's so fundamentally wrong. You know, you're a slave to nothing, to vapor. Yeah. It's a Ponzi scheme. I can make more and more and more, and there's nothing you can ever do about it, but you are striving every day to get it.
Yeah.
It's Fugazi.
That's terrifying and true. Yeah. Yikes. I maybe shouldn't have asked that question. I'm depressed. Oh my God.
I have a more uplifting question, I guess.
Yeah, let's get happier.
What advice do you have for people who want to invest more in crypto or blockchain and want to steer away from normal bank loans?
Well, the first thing I always look at is teams, right? Mm-hmm. When you're looking to invest into blockchain, you have to look at the team that's representing that company. Mm. You know, there's a lot of great coins out there right now. You know, I'm really big on ADA or Cardano. You know, the Ethereum team, half of them are over there. Ethereum's been trying to work on 2.0 forever. It's never happened, and Cardano's already kind of kicked down some of those walls. So it really, do your research. Make sure you're not just following fads. You know, don't buy Dogecoin because some guy on TikTok told you to. You know, it's not a financial asset. It's a meme. Don't do that. You know, I would say don't invest in GameStop right now. It's gonna crash and someone's gonna get hurt. Don't let that be you. Stuff like that. Like, just do your research. You know, there's a lot of great projects out there that I think should come to light, and they will. And there's a lot of projects that haven't even ICO'd yet. And I think if you can get early ICOs and some things that you really care about, that's the ticket to becoming a millionaire. If you can find ICOs, buy in at pennies, and you know, you really believe in it, and it gets to the dollar point and you paid pennies, you're already 100x. So that, yeah, that's really where to go.
In case somebody out there might not know what an ICO is, so sorry. What what is that?
So I think they actually changed the terminology. They don't call it initial coin offerings anymore. They call it initial exchange offerings. So IEOs. Oh, okay. But so 2017 was the years of ICOs. Everyone had a coin. Everyone sent that coin to, you know, to an exchange. People bought the coins up, and they created, you know, the crypto market, right? And so there's a lot of people working on projects like Lightning Coin. I don't think has had their exchange offering yet, but, you know, it's working on making Bitcoin as fast a transaction as, you know, like an XRP or a Ripple. So when you look at those kind of projects, when they do go to, you know, when they go to like a Binance or whoever and have their initial exchange, that's a great time. A lot of them also offer early stage people who really care a chance to buy in before they go on to a stock market. So those are great opportunities.
I have another question for you regarding gaming and crypto. What advice do you give others trying to get into this space if they're trying to make a like a crypto-like game?
So you could use our SDK. It's instant crypto gaming. If you're building anything with Unity, PlayFab, Lumberyard, HTML5, we have an SDK that'll allow you to plug and play. What's cool about that is you'll have 300,000 people that you can farm to come play your game. We have all those people live using our coin right now. So we our API is out there, and our SDK is ready to go. Have fun.
300,000. Wow, that's in how long? I'm sorry, how long did
it took us? Almost a year.
Mind-blowing. Wow.
We started that when COVID hit. So that was like what, March?
Whoa.
And March, and then we now have over 200 streamers that we work with. We've never done a single Facebook ad. We've never done an Instagram ad. We've never done a TikTok ad. All of it direct to consumer, utilizing streamers and hosting events and giving away quarters and prizes.
Wow. That's amazing. Yeah. And it's just going to keep growing. I mean, right?
So we're growing roughly like 10% per week. So keep finding us. We're, you know, 30,000 users. We'll hit 1 million users, I would say, somewhere around June or July.
Let's go.
I would think,
you know, after that million, we'll hit 10 million within the next 6 months. So, you know, we're on a snowball roll, right? We're just going to keep adding and keep going.
You know, it's funny. You mentioned that 2.8 billion people, right, identify as a gamer, but I wonder how many more never even thought to identify as a gamer, but they do play games, you know, at least maybe dabble. Maybe it's not a, like a avid, I game, so I'm a gamer, but more just like, you know, when I got some free time or I just need to blow off some steam, I'm just going to play a game. And that 2.8, I'm sure, goes significantly higher.
I bet it's way higher. My uncle Tommy is like a 7-year-old dude from rural Texas, and he plays Doom and he plays World of Warcraft all the time in his whitey tidies. And he goes out the next morning and he farms. That dude would never tell you he's a gamer. Wow. But every time when he comes in from farming, he's on his computer gaming, and it's on a new computer. He's playing like literally like retro 95 Doom, but he loves it.
When you mentioned, I was picturing him when you were going to say what game he plays. I'm like, Duck Hunt, the Nintendo game that you can shoot the ducks.
He's old school Doom, man. He plays crazy stuff. Like, and you'd have never guessed it if you saw him ever.
That's crazy. I think that it speaks to the fact that it's in human nature to game. There are games that date back like 3500 BC, like early forms of chess and games like, I think it's called like Senet or something, like S-E-N-E-T. It's like a Egyptian game that we played games. Humanity has played games forever. It's like part of our DNA. So, I don't know, any thoughts on that? I mean, it blows my mind when we think like that gamers are this exclusive class of society, but it's, dude, that's just part of us, man. We just play games. It's what humanity does.
I think it still goes back to like generational norms, right? It was not cool to be a gamer. And it's way cooler now. Like it's just normal. Like every kid I know games. You know, but in my, if you played Madden, that's cool, like whatever. But like, if you were like, oh, you know, I'm a level 50 dungeon master, like they're like, oh, bro, I don't know. I'm killing it in Skyrim, like, bro. Like, Halo was about as far outside of like a sports game you could get when I was in school, and so, you know, I just think it's a cultural thing. You know, as we progress and kids get more and more technologically savvy, it's just what they do. You know, everyone games, and these kids just don't care. Like, they're like, you know, they make friends over games. Kids, you know, they're networking on games. Like, it's weird.
Oh yeah.
I used to have to go outside and meet the neighbor. Like, these kids meet like some kid in like Korea, and like, oh, that's my best friend.
I have a buddy who works on an oil rig out in Lubbock, Texas. Yeah. And he got that job because of a friend he made on a guild. I want to say in World of Warcraft. I could be wrong, but he it was part of this guild, made friends with somebody playing games, and he's like, yeah, we need to hire some folks. You can make some good money. This was, you know, years back, and come out to Texas and do this oil rig job. And now he's doing really well. And as we talked about, cost of living in Texas is a little bit lower than out here in California. And he was making good money on an oil rig because of the network he made playing games.
Yeah. And Lubbock's really cheap. Austin's probably the most expensive place in Texas. Lubbock's like, you could buy a mansion for $100,000 in Lubbock. It is very cheap out there.
Wow. To your point, Cody, I think I've met a majority of my like bestest friends playing video games online.
Shout out time.
I wouldn't be part of a ley line unless I had met Oliver through one of my buddies who I met playing World of Warcraft. And I like Bex, she's part of our crew for Discord. She's wonderful. Met her playing World of Warcraft Classic. I was like, oh, now we're friends. So
now
we're
you're
friends now, but I have a bunch of them. One of my best friends, Julian Toast, I love you, man. Known him for almost 10 years now. Played World of Warcraft. Like, I see him, well, not anymore, you know, at BlizzCon, but like every year, and I'd scream across Toast, and then nobody knows his real name, so he would just turn and like, hey, and then we give. It's like, it's crazy, and it as an adult, you know, it's harder to make friends. Because you know, either you're scorned or whatever life has thrown at your way. But when you meet them playing video games, it's like, oh, we're like-minded people. This is, I know you like what I like because we're playing the same damn game. You know, I met one of my best. I'll say one more shout out to my buddy Nate. I love you very much. We played Overwatch, and I had just started playing Overwatch, and we were the same level, and we were always on the opposite teams every match, it seemed like. And instead of just I'll not curse there. Instead of just shooting each other a lot, I was like, hey, do you just want to partner up? Because, you know, we're both mediocre, better than bad. So let's be better than bad together. Yeah, dude, I know his kids. I know his family. You know, he knows. It's crazy. You talk to him every morning. How you doing? What's going on? It's great. He's like one of my best friends now. It's awesome.
Games definitely, you know, like I said, like I told y'all earlier, my best friend is Chris Cross. You know, was a developer of Medal of Honor, and you know, went on to build, you know, a lot of great games. He just built a Pac-Man game, Battle Royale Pac-Man for Bandai Namco, and you know, he's a superstar developer. But you know, it was through gaming that I got to meet, you know, someone that I would have never met. Right? He's definitely much older than me, but you know, every time he was the best man at my wedding. Like, you know, love the guy. He's like the greatest person I've ever met in my life. And there's so many humble people in gaming. I think that's another thing that I've always, like, outside of gaming, because I was in the oil industry before I got into gaming.
Oh, wow.
You know, I feel like gaming, the community is so small amongst us. You know, it's like a giant family. It's really nice how welcoming everybody is once you're like a part of that group.
Yeah, I
would agree. Yeah.
There's plenty of my even just childhood memories that some of my fondest ones were built kind of around games. You know, I met one of a man who was a best man in my wedding, not best man, sorry, groomsman. And I met him in high school because he had this drawing of Red 13 from Final Fantasy VII. And he was across the room, and he had to stand up and do some sort of like science report. And he picked up his thing, and he's, oh, whoops, sorry. And he put that down. I'm like, wait, was that Red 13? And so instantly I have to go, dude, that was Red 13, wasn't it? And he's like, yeah, you play Final Fantasy 7? I'm like, sure do, man. And then suddenly we just hit it off. What, 10 years later, he's one of my groomsmen. Yeah. Just even without online gaming, you know, back in good old console days, only like exclusively console, you know, just it bridge gaps. And I think games throughout history have been sort of a method toward peace. Yeah. Nice. I saw that. That's great.
I knew I liked you. I knew, right? I liked you.
Well, he has,
we're friends now, bro.
Yeah, the Millennium Falcon, you can't really see it though.
I appreciate you, man.
I'm a huge Final Fantasy fan. Legend of Dragoon though is probably my favorite game of all time. And oh, really? Not many people know about it, but it when it comes down to RPGs, it's one of the greatest RPGs ever made.
Final Fantasy VII to me holds a dear place in my heart. I didn't come from a very affluent family. We didn't have very much cash, but I met a dude in high school whose dad was an actual rocket scientist, and he worked for JPL and all sorts of stuff. And he had three brothers. He was older than I am. His younger brother was my like same age as I am, and then he had one more younger brother. And I just kind of just plugged into them, and we would just watch Jonathan. I don't know if he'll ever see this or not, but we'd always just sit like just snack in his room and watch Final Fantasy VII. And like that, like to me, I get why people watch other people stream and hang out with streamers and stuff, because you're watching this, especially games like that, you're watching this great story, you know, come about. And it's like, oh, cool. I didn't play. I just sat and like drank Pepsi and ate Doritos and like, oh, did you see that? Oh, yeah.
I remember doing that too. My mom was asking me why my nephew loved to watch people on YouTube and on Twitch all the time. And I was like, it's the same thing that we did. We sat downstairs and walked past the remote, and you would watch that dude play. And you weren't mad that he took forever, right? You were like getting hyped, like, oh, like I couldn't get past that. Like, this dude's gonna snipe you. Watch, he's gonna snipe you. You're dead.
And then if he died, everybody'd be like, fuck.
Yeah.
Almost said it. I almost said it.
Family friendly.
Yeah,
that's funny, Boogie. I had a similar experience. I had a group of friends. There's three brothers, and so I was just one, and them three, and we played Final Fantasy VII. There was this one night, somebody had put this rumor out. It was just somewhere on the internet that early in the game, if you go to this spot, it's like a respawn point for enemies. These Shinra troops would just keep running out of this hallway. And it said, if you fought them for 12 hours straight, they would finally stop coming. You can go in there and get this item. It was like the rarest item in the game that could do something just radically different. So any Final Fantasy VII fans, it said it would cure Zack. Zack's supposed to be dead, right?
Yeah.
And like, if you fought him for 12 hours, they'd stop coming. And so we started at like 6 p.m., probably copious amounts of Pepsi or Coke, you know, like any caffeine boost. And we rotated, we played, but the same game. And we got to 12 hours. We're hitting 6 in the morning. Nope, they're not stopping. We finally were like, okay, we're at 14 and a half hours straight grinding. And this is like before the second dungeon of the game. And we've got spells that you're not supposed to have for, you know, almost like end game level. I mean, the limit breaks and everything. Like, we were just gods now. And it was like, we had this save file and we're like, okay, let me put in my memory card and save this game. You put in your memory card. Like, we duplicated that save file, like 5 different memory cards, because we were like, as just so beefed up so early in the game. It never worked. It was the whole rumor was false, but darn, were we grinded. Like, it was some seriously good grinding all night long. So that was,
boy, did you learn that if it's on the internet, it must be true. Boy, did you learn.
what do you think about the new Final Fantasy VII remake? Zack's alive.
Did you play it? Weird. Yeah. I mean, they're taking some interesting liberties. I think all of us fans who grew up playing this game,
I was mad.
I know. I'm like, just give me the same game.
Bro, you dead.
But today's graphics. And you know, when they're like embellishing the story and adding all this stuff, I'm cool with it, you know, as long as like the same characters die, the same characters live. I mean, not that I want them to die, you love them, but it's like, certain characters die in this game. Spoiler alert, that means something and it's really impactful and it has a lot of weight for the story. And then you get to the end, and it's like, you're doing like what they did with Star Trek, you know, like, you know, remember the Star Trek remake, you know, the Chris Pine one. And it's like, hey, let's kind of do this sort of like time warp thing. Brand new timeline,
alternate universe.
And, and it's like, well, okay with that with Star Trek, but don't you touch my Final Fantasy VII. Come on. Like this is when I die, I want to go to the world of Final Fantasy VII. That'll be heaven for me. Right. I sure hope like that's my game, man. That's my game. And so
I was a little butthurt when, you know, I was excited, but then I was butthurt when Disney, cause I read the majority of the books in the Star Wars universe. And when they said that those are all like legends,
non-canon.
I just was like, well, so do I just like throw those in the fire everything. Now?
Mara Jade's gone. We're going to get the Yuuzhan Vong. Are they going to? I mean, what?
I was at the first Star Wars celebration in Anaheim, and Dave Filoni, who actually had art for Rebel, or not for Rebels, but at the time Clone Wars, before they were purchased, that had the Yuuzhan Vong ready to rock and roll for their next like season. I was, oh man. But, you know, I got to say, that was like the best thing ever for the Star Wars universe is putting Favreau and Filoni together. Holy moly. I am on board for every single show. I don't know if you guys are or not. I'm definitely on board for every single show.
Book of Boba Fett. Bring it on. Let's go.
Ewan McGregor's coming back as Obi-Wan. Let's go.
No, they're bringing back Hayden Christensen. I'm curious how they're planning on doing that. Like, are we going to have some?
I thought he was going to be like a Force ghost or something like that.
Well, if I understand right, this is between Episode 3 and 4, so Ewan McGregor is kind of between. You know, he's almost to Alec Guinness.
But I thought what Hayden was coming back as is like a Force ghost of Vader before Vader, like before he completely crossed the dark side, he left a light side and created a Force ghost, and that's what is mentoring. I don't know. Maybe I'm out of my own mind. I don't know.
I can't wait.
that's what I was reading, and I probably dove way too deep into like. It's a theory, but we'll see what happens.
That sounds like a deep, like 4 a.m. rabbit hole right there.
Yeah.
I need to get more caught up on this. I feel out of the loop.
Yes, you do. Absolutely.
Two amazing seasons of Mandalorian. Yeah. Just got to go do it right now.
Did anybody else cry at the last episode?
I didn't cry. No.
I cry a lot anyway. I'm a little emo.
I'm sure, you know, I would have cried.
I spent
a
majority of my life
lot.
Getting punched in the face. So it's like all of those like pent up, like, yeah, now I'm like a Facebook or a YouTube. I'm like, but yeah, I was like the baby with the thing in the face. And he took off the thing.
We're dads too, you know. I don't know about you, Tim. Or do you have kids? Okay, but Boogie and I are dads, and that scene. With you know, I still want to call him Baby Yoda, Grogu. I think. How dare I?
No, we're not even friends anymore.
Oh wow!
Yoda.
He was Baby Yoda for like an entire year or two. I mean,
let me break it to you: he was never Baby Yoda, ever.
I thought he was called Baby Yoda. That.
No, he's Grogu.
He's Grogu. I know.
They're all force sensitive. All of Yoda's
species
is super force sensitive, and so that's why they wanted him. And it lived like thousands and thousands of years. So as you get older, you know, your force strength grows. You're right. That's why Yoda was so strong.
Yeah.
And so they wanted him so they could have him on their side, right? But basically everyone that's ever been a species of Yoda's. I don't even know what the species is called.
I don't think they have a name.
They're called Baby Yodas. I'm just kidding. Whoever, any of my friends.
I don't think they actually have a name for the species.
I don't think they do. I don't think they do.
Because there was two Jedi Masters that were both the same species. Yoda, and then there's one that was from like literally like new era Star Wars. Like back when, I can't remember the guy's name.
Knights of the Old Republic or something?
Jamie, pull that up.
It's old Republic, but it's from it's from the books. So I don't know if it's even canon anymore.
Yeah.
There was like a, like, I think it was in, I don't want to say episode two, but it was definitely one of the prequels where you see another guy that looks similar to Yoda. He's like a pinkish skin and he's got like a white hair.
I'm about to Google it.
Yeah, let's Google that.
Yoda species.
There you go. Yeah.
This is what happened.
I really didn't anticipate this going Star Wars, but oh, I'm so into it. I'm
so, we'll be so excited. Yeah.
We have like 10 minutes left, and it's like, yes.
But going back.
Yeah, we'll switch gears. Sorry about that.
Going back
Captain
to
G-Rail strikes again.
Going back to gaming, it's interesting how when you think about it, gaming has been always a part of everyone's lives, just not the type of gaming that we're thinking about. Like Cody mentioned, as a human species, we're always competitive and like to gamify things, which is what Leyline is trying to do, because we understand that there's a drive in us that wants to kind of beat each other, or, you know, have more points, and that's a sort of gamification that incentivize people, and that's what Leyline is trying to do. Can you tell us more about like gaming and human psychology and how games contribute to healthy relationships, or what type of games?
It's a big question.
It's a hard question. Like,
or any of you guys.
I'm trying to pull out my Freud and give you the best answer I can.
I could go first if it's.
Yeah, you go first. Cause
Cody and I have a healthy competition going on right now with our ley line points of seeing who could beat each other. But I spent some ley line points on a gift card, so you might be finally beating me.
I think I got the second to last Bitcoin card, and then I think Bex, I think, got the last one. So,
yeah.
But I have cashed in good 4,000 ley line points for some Bitcoin. So I don't know. I wonder who's winning.
Ooh, I wonder. But it's a healthy sort of competition because we're doing good things while trying to beat each other. So that was my.
How do you earn ley line points? Just so there's a bunch of different activities that you could do on the website.
It's a great question.
What a great question.
Let me flip the interview. Let me talk about Leyline. I asked a lot of stuff, but the last time I talked to Jeremy was early days. So how do you actually collect Leyline points?
Who wants to go?
You want to take this one, Crystal?
Sure.
Go, Crystal.
I'll give it a try this time. Well, there's multiple ways that you can earn Leyline points. One of the easiest ways you can earn Leyline points is just by signing up and going to our website and working out and getting sleep, which is taking care of yourself, healthy body, healthy mind, and you could
every day
get rewards. Yes, there you go.
Why not get rewarded?
So you could get points from that.
Sleep.
Exactly. On the flip side of that, you can actually help donate your computer power while you're not using it to science, to solve algorithms for science.
So do you guys have like a mining app? Is that
No, so we're partnered with a software called Boink, which is run by Berkeley, and all these scientists input the algorithms that they need into Boink, and we actually get to, as a user, we get to choose which algorithm you use our computer power for, and we set our settings up and we click start, and it uses it when your computer is idle, and for how many hours you contribute, it translates into Leyline rewards, which you can cash in for real life gift cards like Amazon, Bitcoin, or even discount codes and things like that.
Yeah, so that was the first thing that Jeremy and I ever talked about, was like the supercomputer to do good things, right? Like that's why he wanted to focus on gaming, because gamers had better computers. And,
yeah.
And so, you know, very similar to like, you know, mining. I always set mine to mine while it idles.
Yeah.
But, you know, I could definitely change that around. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I think that's cool. Yeah. Does Leyline, does it bog down on your GPU? Does it, you know, does it eat away like mining does?
It's excess processing power. Mm-hmm. Doesn't mess with your GPU. So
it's safer than mining.
Yes.
Way safer.
Yes.
And all of these programs go through rigorous like filters on to be part of Boink, which is the app that we use. But they're like you know, traversing the cosmos or helping out with COVID or helping out with cancer or, you know, things that really mean something in the world and out of this world, evidently. So, yeah, it's that's, you know, like, cool. Yeah, like, so cancer played, you know, took a couple people from me that are very, very important in my life. And, you know, if we can help those researchers get those answers faster so they can run more experiments and get closer to the cures of these things. Let's go.
Cancer is a big, I'm actually a survivor. I was diagnosed in 2018 and you know, all my weight is from actually the steroids they put you on after chemotherapy. I was pumped with steroids and gained like 120 pounds. So I'm in the gym 5 days a week now trying to get rid of that. But cancer is something near and dear to my heart.
Man, yeah. Tim, I'm so glad you're here with us. That's really glad. And for me, cancer sucks ass. I mean, I lost a wonderful aunt to cancer, but I've also lost a lot of family members to Alzheimer's. And it's just awful watching like my grandfather, my grandmother on different sides too, like mom's side and dad's side. So it's kind of terrifying at the same time. And so one of the projects that I've been donating my processing power has been working toward Alzheimer's research as well as cancer research. So it's really, really nice. I mean, and if you have a higher level like processor, I think I was recently hearing from Brian, like if you've got different cores or something like that, it can run multiple things. So you might get more than 24 hours worth of processing in 24 hours, but so that we don't have people with maybe like this whole, like, you know, networking bank of computers monopolizing on ley line points because they're just all like, hey, I can run this and get 500 hours a day. We per user account, we cap it at the 24 hours. So, I mean, I got an email from Science United saying, yesterday you did 96 hours. I'm like, in one day, I didn't know my computer did that. All right, that's cool.
I have a monster computer over here. I have a i9 with 230 80 Ti's in it. Founders edition GPUs. I mean, it's a bridge together, monster size, 64 gigabits of RAM. It could take on anything.
So something like that would be able to do like a year worth of research in a day.
Yeah. So,
because there are people that have that computer, that type of computer, we didn't want it to be like, you know, the whales that have
That's smart.
So it's 20, it's just based off of if you have your computer running, depending on, no matter if it's 1,000 hours of usage a day or whatever you're putting into science, you only get 24 hours and it's 10 points per hour that you've put in. That way, nobody just comes and buys up all the stuff.
Yeah. I think the biggest thing that I like is that one, it's not tearing my computer apart, right? Mm-hmm. Mining does tear your computer down. But two, you can then take those ley line points and still buy the Bitcoin that you were trying to mine. You could still go and do the things that you were going to do, right? But now you're doing two things. You're one, getting Bitcoin, and two, you're helping a really great cause. And then, three, if you really want to consider it, you didn't tear your computer to pieces.
That's right. And three wins.
The almighty Chipotle.
That's what I'm going to get next.
You better not get the last one.
Right now. No.
Right on.
We have some questions from chat. It says, what about Tim's ecosystem? What's the best game on your platform?
I think we
talked about this.
Oh, did we answer that? Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
I'm late.
All good. But I did see one of them following you. Yeah.
People want to follow you on Twitter. What's your social?
I don't have a Twitter.
What?
LinkedIn, Instagram, Tello Timothy. Actually, I just started a new Twitter for my podcast that I'm about to start.
Oh, yeah.
It's called gameindustry.gg. And I don't think anyone's following it yet, but if you guys want to go follow
it. We will follow it.
Yeah.
Is it on Twitch?
I'll definitely be one of your podcasts.
It's on Twitch and Twitter. Yeah.
Okay.
I just started both of them. I don't know if anyone follows them. But
but they will.
Gameindustry.gg.
Yes, ma'am. That's it.
Yes.
And right, it's going to be about, you know, me talking to the people I know, you know, guys like Chris, Mark Kaplan, who is the head of licensing for Sony for many years. Actually, he's the guy who took Spider-Man away from Marvel. That's a cool story that I want to talk about. How did he do that? you know how he did it? He's good friends with I don't want to get into it yet, but it's going to be a cool story on my podcast.
Wait, I'm super excited to hear that story. Listening.
Yeah. Yeah, everybody listening with that cliffhanger. Let's go.
Yeah. I definitely want to tune in on that one. Because we got, I don't know, Spider-Man being only Sony. Or I mean, I'm glad that they're bringing him into the MCU. But even on Disney Plus, I was like, Homecoming's not on here. What's going on?
The deal for that's crazy because, and I actually asked Mark about it. Sony gets all the profit for every Spider-Man movie that Disney makes. But without, you know, Disney adding, you know, Spider-Man to the Marvel universe, they're missing such a huge piece. So they had to eat the cost. Sony gets the profit and you get the access to Spider-Man, but Sony will not give it back.
And we get
it's crazy.
I like him as Spider-Man. I like him as Spider-Man.
Oh, me too. Me too. Well, that's the next podcast, right? No, I'm just kidding. We can talk about Spider-Man.
I want to listen to that. I need to know. And if you can't see it in Cody's background, there is a Spider-Man poster. He does.
Yeah, there we go.
And then there's Infinity War. Spider-Man's on that one too. So
I was very close to being the head of licensing at Marvel. I was about this close. For their gaming side. Yeah.
Like my nerd meter just went, oh my god, that's so awesome.
Yeah, I know.
Spider-Man.
Oh my
god. Marvel.
That's cool. Well, hey, you know, we got there. Thank you. It's already been an hour. I mean, it flew by. Thank you so much for participating. I want to pick your brain for like another 4 hours, man. It's been really eye opening. I think for a lot of people, we have a lot of student ambassadors that are listening to this as well, that are definitely would love to pick your brain as well. This is really, really interesting and crazy stuff. And it's cutting edge. And I think more people need to know about it, you know, please check out pocketfulofquarters.gg, POQ.gg. Thanks everybody for listening. Check us out on our Discord. We actually have a pretty active Discord. There's over, I think we reached 335 people today. That's awesome. That's awesome. We have a decent sized Discord there. Everybody trying to save the world. We are a nonprofit, so any help would be great. Please check us out at leyline.gg/donate, or even just sign up. It's cool. It looks great for everybody else. We get more users. Come help us save the world. Please come help us save the world. Sign up for our exclusive beta. If you get in Discord and you just ask, because there's like a waiting list of 1,000+ people. But if you ask in Discord, we'll put you through. Don't forget to tune in next week at 7. Same. Oh, I want to do it every week. I can't.
Bat time.
Can't do it. Same rat time. Same rat channel. No, that doesn't work either. Gosh, oh man.
Turtle time. Ninja Turtles. I don't know.
I was more a fan of the Foot Clan, man. They're ninjas and they're called the Foot.
Yeah.
For my friends here, Cody, Crystal, Tim, thank you so very, very much for being here with me again this week. Change the game, change the world. I love you guys. Lead with love. Always lead with empathy. Show some love. See you guys next week.